Hello guys, welcome to Bhavna's Online Academy. So today we are going to see the chapter number 3 of EIS, that is your information system and its components. Information system and its components. Okay, so I'll open my notes and then we'll start from there. Yes. So I told you the name of the chapter is Information System and its Components, and today we'll be covering the components of information system. Okay, so that is what will be our coverage today. Okay, and this is going to be very detailed, very basic. Even if you're learning for the first time, this is going to be useful to you all. Okay, so first, so I told you the name of the chapter is one. I told you that it is information system. And then I told you that you have about components of information system. Okay. So first we will learn what is information system. You're going to first learn what is information system. For that, we must understand what is system. What is system? Okay. So all your life you might have heard of different kinds of system. You have the solar system, you have the political system, you have the education system, you have medical system. There are a lot of systems that are existing. Okay, so what is a system? What does a system mean? Okay, system means that it is a group of mutually related and cooperating elements having a common goal. What does this sentence mean? That means whenever the system is there, the system will have a goal that it has to achieve. Suppose if you have an education system, the goal of the education system will be to make education system is of India, then the education system of India will have a goal. What will be that goal? Is that they want each and every child of India to be well educated and well informed. That will be the goal of education system. Okay. So, what will be that in the system is there will be a few elements or there will be a few processes that work that you have to start with LKG, you have to complete with 12th standard, then you will give your boards, then you will have your college life. So, there will be a lot of elements in this system, okay? And all these elements in a system will work to achieve a goal. That is what is known as a system, okay? So in a system, what might happen is what will happen is you will take inputs and then you will process it and you will get outputs. So what happens in education system is that your teacher teaches you. That means you take inputs from that and you learn. That is the process of it. And then in your exams, you produce the outputs. So this is what a system does. It takes inputs, it processes it, and it produces output. Okay. So, also it says that there may be several subsystems. That means education system of India might have several subsystems. You may have CBSE schools, you may have matriculation schools, you may have government schools, you may have international schools. There may be a lot of subsystems. Okay, so this is what is a system. Okay, system is nothing but a group of elements which are trying to achieve a common goal. Okay, now we have understood what is system. Next, we have to understand what is information system. Okay, so what is information system is that any system which helps you get information, using technology is known as information system. So any system which gives you information by using technology is known as information system. So here it's written, it refers to the interaction between the process and technology. That means the process or the elements in the system interact with technology and they give you information. This is what is known as a information system. So what is the purpose of this information system? So they tell you that the main aim and purpose of this information system is that it converts the data into information which is useful and meaningful. Okay, so this line that it converts data into information which is useful and meaningful, about this line we are going to read it in the later part of the chapter. So once we complete that, we'll come back to this line and we'll understand what it is trying to tell you. Okay, it is nothing but it is trying to give you information. Okay, so here also the same things only happen. It accepts data as input from the user and it processes it. And then it creates information as output. So input, process, output is what the system does. And this system with the help of technology gives you information. This is what is known as a information system. Okay, so there might be a lot, many kinds of information systems or information systems, but in this chapter particularly we are only going to read about CBIS. That means computer based information system is what we are going to study in this chapter. Okay, so we have now understood what is system, what is information system, and what is that we are going to learn in this chapter. In this chapter, we are going to learn about CBIS. That means computer-based information system. Okay, so now that was the introduction about what information system is, what our chapter name suggests you, information system. Now we are going to start with the chapter. Okay, so it is nothing but we are going to study about the components of this information system. That means for information system to work, or anything to work, if an education system needs to work, you need to have a few elements. You need to have teachers, you need to have people who makes education policy, you need to have schools. So there are a lot of different types of things. You need to have books, you need to have a syllabus. So there are a lot of things that you need a system to work. Likewise, if there is an information system which is working with the help of technology, or there is a CBIS, computer-based information system, that will also have a lot of elements in it. Okay, that is what is known as components. So in our CBIS, that is computer-based information system, we have five elements. Like how in your school, I mean in your education system, you have teachers, you have books, you have syllabus, you have teachers, you have students. So like those elements in CBIS, computer-based information system, also you have totally five elements. So what are those five elements of CBIS is what we are going to see now. First is hardware, then you have software, then you have data, you have network, and you have people. So these are the five elements of information system, and using these five elements only the CBIS is working. Okay, so these are the five components: hardware, software, data, network, people. Repeat after me: hardware, software, data, network, people. So about these five components only we are going to learn in this chapter in detail. Okay, so I hope until now it's clear. Do you have any questions, guys? If you have any questions, you can just post it. I'll see and I'll let you know. Okay, so now we are going to first see how these components of information system works. So now what we are going to see, how all these components, I told you right now, right? You have five components or five elements of information system. So how does all these five elements or components work together is what we are going to see now. So this is an example. Okay, so this is you, this cute little boy or cute little girl. Okay, this is you. Okay, so what happens is that, so how does this information, computer-based information works is that, so now here you have a computer. Okay, so here you have a computer. So what happens is that, suppose this computer is there, right? So in this, what is this computer? This computer is nothing but your hardware. This computer is nothing but your hardware. So that is the first component, done. So this computer is your hardware. What else can come under hardware? The mouse you use, or the keyboard you use, the printers you use, the CPU you use, all these can come under hardware. Okay, so that is hardware. Okay, so that is the first component of information system. So now we are going to understand how this is going to give us information. So now what happens is that you are this person. Okay, you have your journal entries with you. You have journal entries with you. You want to convert this journal entries into a balance sheet or into a profit or loss account. So what do you do? All of you must have heard a software named Tally. All of you must have heard a software named Tally. So what this person does is that he gives input. He gives journal entries into the Tally. He types down all the journal entries into the Tally. And what this Tally software does is that it processes the input. What this Tally software does is that it processes the input and it gives you an output. And it gives you an output of balance sheet or profit or loss account. Okay. So this is how information system works. So what you do, you put in the data of journal entries. This is your data. Okay, and what do you need as an output? You need balance sheet or profit or loss as an output. So with the help of a user, that is people, you put the input into the hardware, and the hardware using the software gives you an output. So here we have understood all, we have understood four main components. One is hardware. Hardware is your computer. Next is software. I told you that Tally is a software, right? So this Tally software you use to get information. Third is data. What is the data that you used here? You gave in journal entries, which is your data. Fourth, leave network. I'll tell you that later. Fifth is people. So people is nothing but the user who put in the information into that system. Okay. And the last one is network. So if you want to share whatever the balance sheet or P&L you have made with another computer, you can do it using a network. Okay. You can do it using a network. So this is how an information system works. So what are the five components of information system? Hardware. Hardware was the computer. Next is software. Software is Tally. Then you had data. Data was the input that you gave in journal entries. Fourth is network. Network is by network is something by which you use to share your data or your information. Fifth is people. So all these components, when they work together, they are known as computer-based information system. So when all these components work together, they are known as computer-based information system. Okay. So I hope this is clear to you. What is computer-based information system? So now what we are going to do is all these five components, one by one, we are going to pick, and about each one of it, we are going to understand now. And this can be a little technical, but I'm going to make it really easy for you. And this is going to be one of the most interesting things you have read in your CA inter syllabus. Okay. So yes, guys. So let's start with all the five components. Okay, so in the exam, rather than asking you what is components of information system, they can also ask you as what are the characteristics of computer-based information system. So the same answer will only prevail. Hardware, software, data, network, people. Okay, awesome guys. So now we are going to start with people. So first, let's start with something known as people. Just give me a minute. Okay, yes. So we'll start from people. So what is people? So what is people? I told you that someone who gives the, here you can see this image. So I told you that someone who gives the input of journal entries into the hardware or the computer is known as the people part. Okay. So people need not be only the users of the computer. Okay. They need not only be the users of the information system. They can also be the people who run the system or who program the system or who manage the system. So everyone who uses the information system will be known as people. They may be the end users. They may be the people who run them, who manage them, who program them. All of these will come under people only. Okay. So see here, people includes anyone who uses the computer-based information system. They may be the internal people, the management or the employees who are using the computers, or they also may be the external people, someone who is coming to manage it, run it or program it or maintain it. Okay. So by this picture, you'll be able to understand that people includes anyone who uses the computer-based information system. They can be end users also. They can be people who run, manage, program and maintain also. Okay, so now we'll read through the text. So what they say is people are the most important element in the computer-based information system that we all know. People, as humans, we are important in any system to work. Okay, we are the base of every system. So people are very important element. Okay, they tell you that the people who are involved in the computer-based information system include... They include the users of the system and information system personnel, including all people who manage, run, program and maintain system. That means whoever use the CBIS or whoever run, manage and program it will be included in people. Okay. I hope this is clear to you guys. Do you have any questions in people? If you have, you can post it. I'll look into it. Okay. So now we have completed our first, we have completed one of the elements or one of the components of information system. Next, we are going to study about the hardware part. We are going to study about the hardware part. Okay. Okay. So here, as you can see on the screen, This is hardware. So in hardware, you totally have four subdivisions. One is input, one is process, one is output, and the fourth one is about data storage. Okay, so now first we'll read what hardware is, and then we'll see about these four classifications one by one. Okay, so I told you, when I told you the example, I told you that this is the hardware, that the computer you are using can be a hardware. So what is hardware? So hardware is any tangible portion of the computer system, anything which you can touch or anything which you can, use or touch or feel, see. Anything which you can see and use or touch is known as tangible portion. Okay. So in hardware, anything which is, in computer systems or in CBIS, whatever the tangible portion is there, it will be known as your hardware. What it may be, your keyboard, mouse, computers, what, printer, scanner, everything that you can see and touch will be known as your hardware. Okay. So they have told you that it basically consists of devices that perform the functions of input and processing, data storage, and output activities of the computer. So hardware, the tangible portion of your computer, will help you in giving the input, such as keyboards. You type something and you give input into the computer. Then the computer will process it. Those devices are also known as hardware only. Then data storage devices, by which you store your data, your pen drives, all those are tangible portions, which is known as your hardware. And finally, output. That means using your printer, you can get output. On your screen, you can get output. All these are tangible portions, which are known as the hardware. So hardware is nothing but the tangible portion of your computer system, and it includes four functions. Okay, it has input, processing, data storage, and output activities, which now we are going to understand in detail. Okay, so now first let's start with input part of it. Okay, so now I hope you are able to see this on the screen. So how and all you will be able to give an input? Okay, so using mouse, you can give an input. You can click on something which the computer will understand that you want to open. That is the input. Or by keyboard, you can type and give an input into the computer. When you are playing video games, when you use your joystick, okay, when you move right and left, that gives an input to the system that you want to move right and left. Then it can be your webcams. That means your image input, you are giving it in the computer. Then your microphone, you may give audio input into the computer using it. Then you have your scanner, by which you can scan and upload something into the computer. This is also a type of input. Then you have your camera and touch screen. When you touch something, it means you want to open it. Likewise, it will open it. So that is the input. So there are different kinds of input. Okay, what are the different types of input is what we are going to study now. So what are the different types of input? You may have text-based input. That means using keyboard, you can give a input. Okay. Next is position-based input. That means, see, now if I'm moving my mouse here and there, that means, or if I'm clicking something with the help of my mouse, it means I'm giving an input using the position-based input. That is your mouse. Okay. Remember, mouse comes under position-based input. Next is image-based input. Suppose you're showing your, you want to click a picture and you're using your webcam to click that picture. That means you're giving the input. That is your image as an image using your webcam. That is a kind of input. And now see, I'm speaking. How are you getting that as an output? Because using my computer or my microphone, I'm giving a voice input, which is reaching you as an output using your speakers that are there on your phone or computer. Next is touch screen. Currently, I'm using a stylus to show you something. So this is a kind of input also. So totally, there are five type of input. Text, position-based input, text-based input, position-based input, image-based input, voice-based input, and screen touch input. Okay, so in your books, you only have these four inputs. This fifth one I have added on my own. Okay, so now we'll read a little bit about what text is given in our ICAI book. So here they have told you, input devices are devices through which we interact with the system. So if you want your system to process something and give you an output, you must first give an input. So using this input devices only, you'll be able to give the input. This is how you interact with the system. Okay. So it includes devices like your keyboard, mouse, touchpad, scanners, barcode, MICR readers, webcam, microphone, stylus or touchscreen. All these examples they have given, and the same thing which I just told you now. You may give a text-based input, position-based input, image-based input, voice-based input. So these are the different kinds of inputs that you can give into the computer, so your into your computer or whatever other technological things are there, so that it is able to process and give you an output. Okay, so this is all about input. So the first classification under hardware is complete. We are complete with what is input. Next, we are going to study about processing. So what is processing? So now you can see a image here. This is the image of a central processing unit, that is nothing but your CPU. So your processing in your computer happens in your CPU only. CPU is like the brain of your computer. Okay, it takes in the input, it processes it, and it gives an output. So the processing part is done in the brain of the computer, which is known as a CPU. So in your childhood days itself, you might have learned what CPU is. You have three components in it. One is control unit. Then you may have arithmetical logical unit, and you may have memory unit. So these are the three components in a CPU: control unit, arithmetical logical unit, and memory unit. Okay. So now regarding this processing or the CPU, we are going to read in detail what is given in our book. Okay. So now here also you can see a image. What happens? You give an input, and what is the CPU does is that CPU processes it and then gives you output using your printer or monitor or whatever it is. So this is how a process works. So now we are currently studying about this one only, processing, about the CPU only we are studying now. Okay, so what have they given you in the book? So they have told you that processing includes central processing units and the main memory. That is nothing but your CPU. CPU is the brain of your computer, which through which every process happens. Okay. So what does this CPU does is that it interprets. So whatever input you are giving into the computer, the CPU interprets it, that what have you given. It tries to decode whatever information you have given, because we all know that computer doesn't understand our language. Computer only understands the language of 1 or 0. So whatever you have given as input, it will try to convert it into the form of 1 or 0 and try to decode it and interpret it. And then whatever you have told to execute the computer, it will execute the program instructions. And it also coordinate how all the hardware devices work together. So once the processing or the execution has been done by the CPU, what another task it does is that it coordinates all your hardware devices. Okay. It tells you after processing it, then it only takes the input. It only gives you the output. So all the hardware devices, this is like the brain. Okay. Like how our brain controls our body, or how all other parts of a body should work. Likewise, a CPU in a computer system or a computer-based information system coordinates how all other hardware devices should work together. So that is the main function of a CPU or the processing unit. Okay, so the CPU is built on a small flake of silicon. Okay, so this is built on a small flake of silicon, and it can only understand the language of binary value 1 or 0. It cannot understand other numbers or other alphabets and all those things. So whatever we give as input, it will convert it into 1 or 0, and it will try to understand that. So this is about processing part. Okay, this is all about your processing part. So what happened was, in the last time we had an explanation about what control unit is, what arithmetical logical unit is, what registers it. All these three components we had information about in our ICI book. But if you open the new ICI book, that is for your November 2020, you'll not be able to see the explanation at all. But still, a little bit of information I'd like to give about this, and then so that you are able to understand the remaining part better. Okay, so now we just have 5 minutes left. So what I'll do is I'll just take up any questions that you have, and then we'll end up the meeting. Is everything clear until now? Do you guys have any questions? Is everything clear, guys? Do you have any questions? You can please ask me. Is it clear? If it is, just send me a yes. Okay, I hope you guys don't have any questions. So since we don't have all these part, that is about your control unit, ALU unit, registers, and all of that, in last time you had it, but this time the portion has been deleted. Okay, so but still I'll try to explain it to you in a very simple way, because the understanding of that is very much required for you to understand the remaining part of the chapter. Okay guys, so now just think as if you're going to a hotel. Okay, everybody must have gone to a hotel. Okay, this is the hotel. Now I know that it's quarantine, I mean it's locked down, and it's just released, but I don't think many of you might have visited until now. But still, whenever you go to a hotel, you go and sit down on your tables, and then you make an order. With the help of whom do you make an order? You make an order using the with the help of the waiter who is there. Okay, so what the waiter does, the waiter gets your order, and the waiter then goes to the kitchen of the hotel, and then he tells the chef, whoever is preparing the meal, he will tell that this is all the things that you need to prepare, and the chef will do all the work. Okay, so what sometimes happens is that this waiter who is there, on Sundays or on Saturdays, what might happen is a lot of orders you will get, okay, because there will be a lot of customers who have come to the hotel. So in such case, what might happen is that if the waiter is directly going that and telling to the chef that this you have to do, the chef may get confused of what and all he has to do, because there will be so much of things that he has to do. So what in such case might happen is the hotel management might appoint a manager for the kitchen, that he manages all those orders and tells the chef what he has to do and what he has not to do. Okay. So this is the same thing that happens in your CPU also. So the waiter who is there, this waiter is the registers. The waiter is the registered. So whatever input you give into the computer, the process starts from the registers part only. What the registers does is it gets the order, and then it pushes it to the ALU unit. But sometimes what happens is ALU unit, that is, ALU is nothing but a unit where all the arithmetic operations and all the logical operations are performed. So when sometimes it gets overloaded or it's not able to perform properly, the control unit helps in managing the flow of data and instructions that are coming from and to the memory. Okay. And it helps to interpret the instruction and control the task and execute them. So this is how a control unit helps a arithmetic unit to perform its task. Okay, just take this basic understanding. This wasn't needed, but still, to make you understand what the concept is, here we'll read this line so you understand better. So what the control unit does is that it tells the ALU what operations it has to perform on the data, and the ALU stores the result in an output register. So once the chef, or once the order has been made by, or once the food has been prepared by the chef, it will again give it to the waiter, right? So waiter is able to give it to the customer back. So that only ALU also does. It stores the result in an output register. That means it gives back the output to the registers, and the control units moves the data between the registers, the ALU and the memory. Okay, that means this person will only go and give the order to the waiter. Once the chef prepares it, the chefs will either directly give it to the waiter, or the manager will help him to give it to the waiter. So this is the basic understanding of what you can have about control unit, ALU and logical unit. Here in this chapter, you need to only understand importantly about registers, okay? So registers may be of different kinds. Right now, you don't need to study. You just can understand that registers are nothing but a high speed memory. Okay, just like your waiters, it will be very quick, very speed. It wants everything to get done fast because it wants to satisfy the customers. Okay, it is a high speed memory unit within the CPU, and it stores only small amount of data. That means once waiter gets your order, it will go and give it to the chef. That's it, it will clear it data. Next day order it will take, it will go and give it to the chef, clear data. So like that, only small amount of data it will be able to store. From morning to night, whatever data it is having, all the bills it will not have in its hand, right? The waiter will not have all the bills in his hand. So these are high-speed memory units which are within the CPU, and it stores only small amount of data, mostly 32 or 64 bits of data. Okay, so I hope the basic understanding of processing is clear to you all. Okay. This you don't need to understand, it's okay. So now we have understood about input and processing. So the next thing which comes under hardware is the output. Now next we are going to study about output. So you can see these are the output devices. Okay, what are the output devices? These are your speakers by which you can hear the output of a sound. This is your monitor. That means once something has been processed, the screen will display that in your monitor. Next is a projector. By you, that also you can see output. Printer, if you give print something, then as a print it will come out. That is the output. Okay, then this is nothing but all your screens and all the stuff. So these are the output devices. Now we are going to understand about these output devices. We have understood about input and processing in detail. Now we are going to understand about output. Okay, so this is nothing but this is your third component of hardware, your tangible devices. Okay. So there are five types of output which you can get. There are five types of output which you can get. One is textual output. In the form of text, you can get output. Okay. Next is graphical output. That means in the form of images or flow charts or any other kinds of graphs or charts, you will be able to get output. That is known as graphical output. Okay. Next is a tactile output. That means what happens is for the blind people, you will get output in the form of raised line drawing so that the blind people are able to understand. So output which you get in the form of a raised line drawing will be known as a tactile output. And please remember this one, okay? Raised line drawing is a part of tactile output and it is useful for blind people. This may ask in a MCQ. Okay. Next is audio output, which you can get. And then last is you can get output in the form of a video also. Okay. So now we are going to study about the output devices. So output devices are devices through which the system responds. So once you have given the input and once the system has processed this, it has to respond, right? By something. So it is responding by the use of output devices. So what output devices help you to do is it helps the decision makers to solve business problems with the output. Suppose now we have given the input of journal entries. What the computer will do is with the help of a software, it will process everything. Okay, once it has processed, it will give us an output of balance sheet or P&L. Such a balance sheet or P&L will help the decision makers in a firm or in an entity to take decision and solve business problems, the balance sheet or P&L. Okay. Next is output. I already told you output may be in the form of visual, audio or digital forms. Okay. Common output devices are printers, speakers, etc., monitors also. Now I already told you about types of outputs. That's what given here. Textual output, that means it will comprise of characters. That means it can be words, sentence or paragraphs. Then you have graphical outputs. It may be in the form of digital representation of non-text information. It will not be in the form of text. It will be a non-textual information. It can be drawings, charts, photographs, animation. Okay. Next is tactile output. Tactile output, I told you that it will be in the form of raised line drawings, which will be useful for individuals who are blind. Next, you have audio output, which may be in the form of music, speech, or any other type of a sound. Next is video output, which will be in the form of the images played back at speeds to provide appearance of a full motion. That may be movies or something like that. Okay. So now we have completed with our output part also. So we were studying about the components of information system. In that we already completed one of the components, that is people. We are on to our second component, that is your hardware. In the hardware, we have completed three. In hardware also, you had four subdivisions, out of which three of them, that is input, processing and output, you have completed. The last part and one of the most interesting, I would say, rather than technical, is your data storage classification under hardware. This is one of my favorite topics into the chapter. Okay, so from now you will have to have a keen observation on what I say and try to make notes then and there possible, or if you are able to mark it in your ICI textbook also, that will be totally fine. Okay, I hope everybody is listening. Just give me a minute. Okay, guys. Once again. Okay. So now we are going to see about the fourth classification of output, that is hardware. Data storage. So data storage means now once you have done your input, you have given your input, you have done processing it, you have got an output. That output now you will need to store somewhere, you know, or else data you will need to store somewhere, right? This data you will need to store somewhere, right? So all regarding this data storage, you have a few devices there that can be RAM. It can be a system in which you store. It can be a CDs in which you store your data, or you may use a USB flash drive or a pen drive. You may have internal hard disk, or you may have external hard disk. Like this, different kind of data storage devices are there, okay, by which you can store your data. This data storage devices can also be inbuilt in your computer, or it can be external also. Inbuilt maybe RAM, ROM, internal hard disk, whereas external will be external hard drive, pen drives. So you can both have internal and you can also have external data storages. Now we are going to study about data and its storage in detail. First, we'll understand what is data storage devices. So data storage devices refers to the memory where data and programs are stored. Like how in a human body, in its memory, we have our data and all other things stored. Likewise, in a computer also, in the data storage devices, data storage devices are those parts of the computer or those memory, you can say. Okay, memory where you store everything. Okay, so this memory, fine. Now, in this data storage devices also, you have four kinds of data storage devices. You have totally four kinds of data storage devices. One is internal memory, you have primary or main memory, you have secondary memory, and you have virtual memory. So there are four types of data storages or a memory in which you can store your data. There are four kinds. Repeat after me, guys. Internal memory, primary or main memory, secondary memory, virtual memory. So these are the four kinds of memory. Now each one of these, one by one, we'll read. Okay. Okay, guys. Now, first we will start with something known as internal memory. So, under internal memory, you have two parts again. So, internal memory can be either registers or a cache memory. This CACHE is pronounced as cache. Okay, see, like CASH. It's a cache memory. Okay. So, now regarding this registers, where did we already read, guys? Internal memory registers, they have told you that you have processor registers. Regarding registers, before itself, you have written some other part. Where did you read about it? Can I get a quick answer, please? Anyone? Yes, very good, Pratipa. We already studied in CPU that you have a registers here. Okay, that register, now what we are studying in the internal memory is same as what you studied in registers. They both are same. In CPU, whatever registers you study and whatever registers you had in your internal memory is same. But one thing what you must understand is that there are different kind of registers. There are different kinds of registers, okay? Now, what we are going to study in the internal memory is the storage registers. What we are going to study in the, internal memory is the storage registers, okay? Okay, guys. Okay, so now we will study about internal memory. So I told you internal memory have two components in it. One is the processor registers, or you can call it as registers, and the cache memory. About cache memory, we will read once we have studied about RAM, ROM, and all of those things. About the registers alone, I will tell you now. Okay, about the registers alone, I'm going to tell you now. So registers are internal memory within the CPU. We have already read this, and they are very fast and very small. I already told you they are very fast, like waiters. Quick, quick, quick. They want to get all the orders done. And also they are very small, like how the waiters don't store all the information or all the bills with them for the whole day. Then and there, once the task is completed, they just remove off the bill from their hand. Like that only, this is also there. So it is very small and it doesn't have much storage. Okay. So this is about your processor register. So in internal memory, now we have studied about what registers are. This about this already I've told you. About cache memory, we'll study a little later. Okay. So now we'll move on to So now we have studied about internal memory, in which cache memory is remaining. I'll tell about it later. Okay, next we are going to study about primary or main memory. Now we are going to study about primary or main memory, and we'll also simultaneously study about secondary memory. Okay, very good. So now, just give me a second. Okay, we'll just take. So everybody here must have a phone. We'll take the example of a phone. This is your mobile phone. In this mobile phone, what happens is, okay, just tell me the 2 to 3 apps which you use most frequently in your phone. 2 to 3 apps or applications on which you love the most or which you use the most, whatever it can be. Just name 2 to 3 apps that you have in your phone, guys. Can I get a few answers? WhatsApp, Instagram, YouTube. Very good, very good, very nice. So these are the Spotify, if your Gaana app, you have your Telegram, even Zoom is the app, Wink is the app, PUBG is the app, everything is an app. Okay, Snapchat, Jio, Savan. Okay, so all these are apps. Okay, so have you ever thought, where are these apps stored in our phone? Where are these apps stored in our phones? Where are these apps stored in our phones? Okay, so now I will tell you where these apps are stored in a phone. So in your phone, you have something known as your, you have something known as your secondary memory. Wrong. It is not stored in RAM. No, apps are never stored in RAM. This is where you guys go wrong. Now I'll tell you, now you will understand. Oh, this, you know, this is very, very interesting. Okay, listen. So there are secondary memory in your, so whenever I say that you have secondary memory, everybody thinks of something like pen drives or external hard disk or things like that. But it's not the case. Secondary memory can also be inbuilt in your mobile. It can also be inbuilt in your mobile. In your mobile itself, you might have an inbuilt storage area. Like how in your laptops or computers, you have inbuilt hard disk. Likewise, in your phones also, you might have inbuilt secondary storage. Inbuilt secondary storage. Okay, so in this secondary memory only you will have all your apps stored. In the secondary memory, one second guys, in the secondary memory only you will have all your loved and all your favorite apps stored. So what will happen is that whenever suppose you are using a WhatsApp, okay, this is your WhatsApp. Suppose this is the WhatsApp. Now what happens is that now what I want to do is I want to use WhatsApp. Now I want to use my WhatsApp. So what I do is, what I go is I go and click on the WhatsApp. I go and click on the WhatsApp. So what happens when I click on the WhatsApp is that the WhatsApp, I told you that all the apps are stored in your secondary memory only, right? So what happens is that whenever I click on the WhatsApp, the information goes to registers. The information goes to registers, as I already told you. Okay, this information first goes to registers. He is like the waiter of our mobile phone. And what the food requirement is? The food requirement is our WhatsApp. Okay. Okay, so this is our waiter. So what happens is that whenever I say that I want to, whenever the phone receives the information that I want to use WhatsApp, so what happens is that this information first goes to the registers. So what this registers will do is that this registers will want to contact with the secondary memory and tell them that please give me this or please help me use this app because the user wants to use it. Okay, please help me display it. What happens is then there is a problem here. There is a problem here. What is the problem? The problem is that registers cannot directly talk to secondary memory. The registers cannot directly talk to your secondary memory. Like how, you know, in few of our households, okay, I don't think it's prevalent in South India, but in North India, how you have is, if there is a housewife, the housewife will not be allowed to talk to the husband's father or husband's mother or father. She'll not be allowed to talk to. This happened in olden days, okay? So whenever this mother or father needed some information from the housewife, it used to go through her husband only. This whatever the mother and father asks the housewife, the wife in the house, or the what do you call, what are the other terms I can use? I'm sorry if I'm using the wrong term, I just don't know what to say. Okay, so what happens is that this housewife will provide whatever information is asked by the mother-in-law or father-in-law from the or will give the information to the husband, and then the husband will give the information to the mother and father. This is what used to happen in the olden days, right? So same way, like that, only this registers is nothing but your mother or father-in-law, and the secondary memory is your housewife. What do you call housewives? I mean, what do you call your daughter-in-law or something like that, right? Okay. So what happens is, then in middle, there will come a husband. Who is this husband? This husband is none other than your RAM. This husband is none other than your RAM. So what will happen is, since registers cannot directly talk to secondary memory, whenever you click on the icon of WhatsApp, this registers, what will happen is, the secondary memory, whatever app is required by the registers, will send the app to RAM. Okay, we'll send the app to RAM. So in the RAM, this app will come. This, what do you say? Sorry. This WhatsApp app will come in the RAM, and then the user will be able to use it. So what happens, I'll just give you a summary of it quickly. So whenever you want to use the app, the apps are usually stored in the secondary memory. Okay. Whenever you click on an app, the registers is the person who will want to get the information. So the registers will try to contact the secondary memory, but it will not be able to do, or it is not allowed to do. So in such case, what happens is, since all the apps are stored in secondary memory, for the meanwhile, when you are using the app alone, this app will get shifted to your RAM. Your RAM is like the husband who is going to give information to the registers. Okay. So this app for the some time or for meanwhile or not, it will move on to the RAM, that is your read-only memory, and it will display it to you. Is this working clear, guys? How registers, RAM, and secondary memory use? Do you have any doubts? We'll read through the text so you understand better. Do you guys have any doubts? Clear? Yes, very good, guys. Very good. Okay. So now we shall read through the text. Okay, so yes, see here I have written about RAM. Okay, so RAM, what it tells you is that, see, CPU or the registers, what I mean here is the registers. So the registers cannot directly talk to the secondary memory. So what it will do is, it will talk through your primary memory only. So example, when you open a WhatsApp which is stored in the secondary memory, it will open or get shifted to your primary memory, that is your RAM. Okay, and the CPU will talk to the RAM, and then the CPU will be able to talk to the RAM, as it cannot talk to the secondary memory, but it can talk to the RAM. So your app will get shifted to the RAM. Okay, so now this part alone you understand. Okay, so this is what I explained you now. Okay, so what happens is that, I'll just complete one more concept here itself, so you are able to understand. Okay, here I told you that I'll explain you about cache memory in some time. Where did it go? One second, guys. I just... Okay. So here is the cache memory. I told you I'll talk about this cache memory in a while. So what happens is that, I told you that this is how the thing works. You have secondary memory, then you have your primary memory. In primary memory, RAM is the one which helps you. ROM doesn't help you in this. What is the use of ROM? ROM, I'll tell you in a later part. Okay, and then registers. So what happens is that, registers, I already told you that they are very fast memory. And comparatively, the speed of the primary memory is a little bit low, or a little bit less faster. Or comparatively, you can say slower than the registers. Okay, the speed of primary memory is not as much as the registers. But the storage in registers, is very small. But the storage in RAM will be high. Okay, this part you can ignore. Just concentrate on the part of the speed part alone. You can concentrate now. So what happens is that, once the app is shifted to the primary memory, what happens is that registers are very fast. It will be like give, but the primary memory will be, so what will happen? I'll show you a diagram here. So this registers will be like give, But the primary memory will be like, I am giving you. So what will registers do? Give. What primary memory will do? I am giving you. So in this process, what will happen? The registers will get frustrated. Okay, it will get like, what is this happening? Why is this so slow? It will get very frustrated, right? Like how when I ask you some questions, you're not answering, how I get frustrated. Same way, this registers also will get frustrated. So for that, we have a, we have something known as cache memory in between. We have something known as the cache memory in between. So what this cache memory does is that it bridges the speed difference between your registers and primary memory. So cache memory is not as fast as your registers. It is also not as slow as your primary memory. It is just in between. It is just perfect. It's just in between. Okay. So it will bridge the gap between your registers and primary memory. So what this cache memory will do is that, so whatever your frequently used applications are there, you know, that is, it may be your WhatsApp, it may be your Instagram, or it may be your YouTube. So whatever your frequently used applications are there, all these frequently used applications will get stored in this cache memory. So whenever these frequently used apps are asked from the registers to display, it will not now contact with the primary memory. It will directly contact the cache memory and get the information. That's why whenever you use phones, you know, whatever your frequently used apps are there, it will open very quickly. Whereas whatever your least use apps are there, you know, it will take a while to open. Why does this happen? Because whenever you open your frequently used apps, it will directly take the information from cache memory and display you. So the speed will be a little better. But whereas if you have your non-frequently used apps, not so frequently used apps, it will get your information from the primary memory that is RAM. That's why the display speed is a little lower. So this is how your cache memory works. Is cache memory clear to you guys? I think this is one of the easiest ways I could explain you cache memory. Is it clear? Yes. Okay. Yes. Very good. Very good. So now let's read what is given in the cache memory once. Okay. So here, see, now if you read through the text, you will understand. So what is cache memory? Cache memory is to bridge the huge speed differences between your registers and the primary memory. Here, primary memory, what it is referring to? Let me see if you are able to answer here. Primary memory means what? RAM or ROM? Primary memory means what? RAM or ROM? Very good. The answer is RAM here. I'll tell you what is the use of ROM afterwards. Okay. So we have cache memory for that purpose. So cache is a smaller but a faster memory which stores copies of data from the most frequently used main memory locations, that is your apps or whatever. So the processor registers can access it more rapidly than main memory. So also one more point here. So see, registers is very fast. Cache memory is a little slow. Primary memory is slower than that. RAM is slower than that. Whereas if you consider in the form of storage, secondary memory has the highest storage, a bit of lesser storage in your RAM. From that, a storage, little bit of less in cache, and the least storage in your RAM. So in form of speed, it will go this way. In the form of storage, it will go this way. I hope the difference you have understood between the fastness and the storage between all those four. I've spoken so much. I'll just take a 1 minute break until you can answer it. Answer this question. MCQ question. Which among the following is a smaller, faster memory which stores copies of data from the most frequently used main memory locations? A, primary memory. B, virtual memory. C, cache memory. D, secondary memory. Cache memory. Very good, guys. Okay. It seems we have 10 minutes left for the meeting. It's okay. We'll still continue with the topic. If the meeting gets ended, you guys can join back again. Okay. Once again. Still need this. Okay. Okay, so yes, now we have already completed everything about internal memory. We have also already completed registers and we have completed cache memory. We were studying about primary memory. We learned a little about RAM. Now that about RAM in detail we are going to understand. Okay, so what happens whenever you buy a phone? Whenever you buy a phone, what are the features you look for in a phone? Do you guys see what is the RAM in your phone or not? Or what is the current RAM in your phone? Can you guys tell me if you would have noticed? What is the current RAM in your phone? 4 GB? 4? Anybody who has a higher or lower RAM? 6 GB RAM? 4 GB RAM? What does this 4 GB or 6 GB RAM means? Can someone tell me? Whenever you buy a phone, everybody sees whether it is 4 GB RAM or not. Okay, speed? No, not exactly speed. This is where this is the importance that you should understand. EIS, access, power, speed. No, not actually speed. In a way, but it's not for speed actually. Like where apps are stored, I told you apps are stored in secondary memory, so RAM doesn't come in place at all. So in your phone, you might have like 4 GB of RAM, but you may have 64 GB of secondary memory or storage. Phone won't get hang easily. Close by. Processing power, close by. Not exactly. Okay, so now let's understand. Is the class interesting, guys? Are you liking the class? Is the class informative and interesting? Now we are going to understand more about it. So next time you buy a phone, understand what the RAM is about. So you will be able to buy a phone according to your requirements. Okay. Yes. Very nice, guys. I hope all your energy levels are up. Okay. So now let's understand. Now I told you that there may be few phones which has a 4 GB of RAM and 64 GB of secondary memory. Secondary memory. Okay, so what happens is that, one second guys, just give me a second. Okay, so what happens is that I told you, whenever you want to open an app, suppose you want to open a WhatsApp, you know, there will be different kinds of apps in your secondary memory. There will be different kinds of app in your secondary memory. Okay, each app may take a specific amount of storage. A few app will take 700 MB of storage. A few app may take 1 GB of storage. A few app may take 200 GB of storage. Like this, different kinds of storage each app may take. Okay, each app may take a different kind of storage. So up to 64 GB of apps or data or files you can store in your secondary memory. This is what the use of secondary memory. How much apps or files or those things you can store in your secondary memory. Okay, just one more important thing. Your apps does not only mean your social networking sites, but also your Excel, your MS PowerPoint, all these also come under apps. We'll read about this in the later part. Okay. So now what happens is that whenever you're using an app, okay, whenever you're trying to use app, suppose now I take the example. Now I want to open 5 apps. Now I want to open 5 apps at once. So what? So just ignore this. Okay. So what happens is now first what was happening was I was using Telegram and I was giving you information about the class. Okay. So suddenly what happens when I was doing my Telegram thing, I got a call from WhatsApp. So here what happened when I opened my Telegram got moved into my RAM. Telegram got moved into my RAM because I told you whenever you use a RAM, you can only use it from the, whenever you use the app, you can only use it from the primary memory. You can not directly use it from the secondary memory. So whenever I am using Telegram, my Telegram will be transferred or shifted to RAM. So Telegram has taken up 1 GB of RAM, suppose. 1 GB of RAM space, this has taken, my RAM space is only 4 GB. So once 1 GB of RAM space, Telegram is already taken. Now suddenly get a call from WhatsApp. So when I get a call from WhatsApp, I open my WhatsApp also. So whenever I click WhatsApp, my Telegram is already opened only. Okay, I've not closed my Telegram yet. But I open my WhatsApp now. Closed in the sense, what happens is that if I had a mobile with me, I would have shown you. Whenever you open a mobile, you know, you will have this middle button where you can see whatever apps you have opened. Are you able to understand? Once only if you clear this app, that will go from there. or else this app will stay in the open only. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Do you guys understand? You will have a button, recent apps. Yes, very good. So you have a recent apps tab in your mobile phone. Until you don't clear all your recent apps, that will stay in that open only. It will stay open only. Correct? So like that, I didn't close my Telegram. It's still there in the recent app only. Now say I get a call from WhatsApp and I attend the call from WhatsApp. So my WhatsApp also gets opened and then it goes to primary memory. That is my RAM. It covers another 1 GB. It covers another 1 GB of storage. So now how much storage I have left in RAM? 2 GB. So more 2 GB amount of storage I have opened. I mean, I have left in RAM. So 2 GB of apps I can open. So while I was getting a call on WhatsApp, I wanted to refer to something I was speaking on the call. I wanted to tell my friend that there is an Instagram profile which I just saw recently, and the girl or the boy in the Instagram profile looks very beautiful or very handsome. So I wanted to share that Instagram profile name with my friend on the call. Okay, we all do this. We all know. So I opened my Instagram. Next, what I opened? I opened my Instagram. When I opened my Instagram, suppose the username was ABCD. So now I was telling her that the username is ABCD on the call. Then I opened my Instagram app also. Suppose Instagram takes away 1.5 GB of data. Then Instagram will also get opened on the RAM. Correct? So 1.5 GB of data over here. So I've already occupied 3.5 GB of data I've already occupied. Only 0.5 GB of data is left. Only 0.5 GB of data is, I mean, storage space is left. Now next, what happens? While I was speaking on the call, while I was telling her the ID, what happened was there was some kind of use that I had to open my PDF viewer also. I had to open my PDF viewer also. Because we then started to discuss about studies, I didn't close any of my recent tabs. So my PDF viewer, what happens? My PDF viewer is of 1 GB now. Now, what happens is that whenever I'm going to try to open my PDF viewer of 1 GB, it has to come to RAM, right, to work. For the registers to take that and display onto our screen, the PDF, this need to be transferred to the RAM. But since this is of 1 GB and the RAM space, what I've left is 5 GB only. What happens? When you open a 1 GB data here the system starts hanging. So this is the main use of RAM. Do you guys understand what I'm trying to tell here? Why RAM is of use? What this 4 GB of RAM means here? So it is how much apps you can open at a time or how much applications you can open at a time. Okay. So the higher the RAM space or higher GB of RAM, higher the applications you will be able to use at a particular point of time. Do you guys have any doubts in this, guys? This is when your system starts hanging, when your RAM space is less, but you open more apps than the RAM space. Anybody who has doubt in this? We have 1 minute left. I can take any doubts that you have. No? Clear? Clear. Okay. So now we are going to start and study about. Now we are going to start and study about the, RAM. Okay. 1 second, guys. Okay. So here you can see. Okay. So here it's written, see, higher the RAM, higher the number of applications you'll be able to use at a time. Okay. This example you don't need to understand. You just have understood. Okay. Okay. Now we have understood what RAM is. So now we are going to understand about now we are studying about data storage in which we completed internal storage. We are on to our primary storage in which we studied about RAM. Now we will study about ROM. R-O-M. So what happens is whenever you switch on your phone, okay, whenever you have switched off your phone and whenever you restart it or reboot it or on the phone, you will always see a symbol that appears when the phone is getting started. Okay, what is that symbol? Suppose you have MI symbol. If you have a Xiaomi phone, then MI symbol will pop up. If you have a OnePlus phone, the symbol of OnePlus, I think it's something like this. I'm not sure. That symbol will pop up. Like this, what happens is there are a few things that are inbuilt in the mobile itself, which you cannot change. As a user, you cannot change it at all. If the system is going to open and you have a symbol of MI displaying whenever you reboot it, that means that symbol will display only. You cannot change the symbol into something, okay, or something different. So these are the things which are put in by the manufacturers of mobile phones. Which the users of the mobile phones cannot change. This is only read only. You cannot modify whatever is given already. Okay, this is nothing but. So where will these things be stored? That whenever a screen opens, MI symbol should display. Like this, there will be different things which are put in by the manufacturers. So where will these things be stored? All these things will be stored in your read only memory. So this is the purpose of read only memory. Okay, so read only memory means you can only read it, you cannot modify these things, and these are the few things which will be put in by the manufacturer, which you cannot change by your change as a user. Okay, so I hope it is understood. So see, some instructions which are put up by the manufacturer, like the logo of MI to be displayed whenever the phone turns on. These instructions needs to be stored somewhere. So where it will be stored? It will be stored in your ROM, that is your read-only memory. I hope your read-only memory is clear to you all. Now we shall study the difference between RAM and ROM. Random access memory and am I saying that right? I think I'm right. Random access memory and read-only memory. Am I right, guys? Can you just give me a validation that if I'm right or wrong? It's random access memory and read-only memory, right? Yes. I don't know why I just went blank for a minute. Okay. Yes. So, random access memory and read-only memory, the difference we are going to study now. So, random access memory is a volatile memory and read-only memory is a volatile or non-volatile memory. What does volatile means? Volatile means this is permanent in nature. This is permanent in nature. Volatile means it is temporary in nature and non-volatile means it is permanent in nature. Okay, that means whenever you switch off and on a phone, suppose you were using some kind of application and suddenly your phone gets hanged. What you do is you switch off the phone and switch on the phone. When you switch off and on the phone, what happens is when you switch off, whatever data was there in the RAM or whatever applications were open in the RAM, everything will get erased. Okay, that means all recent apps will be cleared. Okay, so this is the volatility. That means if the power goes off, the data will be gone here. Okay, whereas in read-only memory, if you on and off the mobile 100 times also, if the logo of the MI has to appear on the screen, it will appear on the screen. So this data is permanent. The data which you store, which is there in a RAM, is temporary or volatile, whereas on ROM, it is non-volatile or permanent nature. In RAM, you can both read and write the data. That means you can also see the data and also you can write means you can modify the data. Whereas on read-only memory, you can only read. You cannot modify any data which is put in by the manufacturer. Okay, RAM. In RAM, it is your stored for real-time use. That means in that time, in that particular time, if you are using the app only, it will be stored in RAM. Otherwise, it will not be stored in RAM. Okay. So, real-time use means currently you must use it. Okay. So, it is responsible for storing the instructions and data that the computer is using at the present moment. If you are using WhatsApp now it will be open or else it will be closed. If you are using Telegram or Instagram now it will be opened or it will close. Whereas this storage is for repeated use. Again and again you are going to use the MI logo. Okay. RAM has more storage in terms of GB, whereas comparing to RAM, ROM will be of a lesser storage. In MB only it will be, okay? So GB means a higher form of storage, MB means a lower form of storage. I hope you know that, okay? Because in Roan there will be not many things that the manufacturer would have stored in it, okay? So lesser storage is enough. So now we are completed with internal memory and primary memory or main memory, which is a classification of RAM and ROM. Now we shall move to the secondary memory. Okay, now you can see pictures here. Secondary memory can either be inbuilt in the computer or mobile also, and they can be external also. Always remember that, okay? It may be CDs, it may be your memory cards, then you have your pen drives, you have your floppy disk, all of those things, okay? Other things also, internal hard disk, external hard disk. All these memory devices are known as secondary memory devices. Any memory device other than RAM and ROM will come under secondary memory devices. Okay. So secondary memory devices, I already told you what the use of secondary memory devices is. It. All your applications and data in the phone or laptop is stored in your secondary memory. I already told you this when I was talking about RAM and ROM. You know, well, just read through what secondary memory is. Okay. So CPU refers to the main memory for execution of programs, but these main memories are volatile in nature and small in storage capacity. So what it tells you in this sentence is that CPU refers to, that means whenever registers want to open an app or display an app, it goes to the main memory for execution. That means it goes to the RAM for execution. Okay, but what happens is that the main memories, that is this RAM, are volatile in nature. That means whenever you switch off the phone, it will go, the data will go off from the RAM. It is temporary data. And also the storage capacity is very small in RAM. So what we do is we bring something known as a secondary memory in place. So what happens is secondary memory are usually bigger in sizes. That means if your RAM is of 4 GB, your secondary memory can be of 64 GB, okay? And thus your programs and data can be stored on secondary memories. Also, this is kind of non-volatile only. If you switch off your phone, your WhatsApp will not go away from your phone. It will stay on the phone only. Okay, only the recent thing will go away from the phone. So your secondary memory is kind of a non-volatile data only. So to solve this problem, they brought in your secondary memories. So now we are going to study the features of secondary memory devices. So they are non-volatile. I already told you that it is permanent kind of a storage. Next, they have greater capacity as compared to your RAM. If your RAM is 4 GB, this will be 64 GB. Greater economy, that is, it is cheaper than RAM. If you go and buy a RAM, or if you go and buy a secondary memory will be way less cheaper. If suppose you are going and buying 1 TB of just an example, okay, 1 TB of a secondary memory, it will be around 3,000 to 4,000 rupees, whereas if you go and buy 1 TB of your RAM, it can cost you around 8,000 to 10,000 rupees. So RAM is costlier than your secondary memory. So secondary memory is greater in economy also, as it is cheaper than RAM. Next is slow speed. That means this is way slower than RAM and registers. So registers are the fastest. Next is cache memory. Next will be your RAM, and the last will be your secondary memory, but opposite in the vice of storage. So secondary memory will have the highest storage. Next is RAM. Next is cache, and next is registers. I hope this relation between all these four things are clear to you all. So now we have completed with secondary memory also. The last thing that we have in data storage devices is regarding to our virtual memory. Okay, guys. Now what we'll do is we'll just take a 2 minutes break. It is 11:16. We will start about regarding virtual memory by 11:20. Okay. Okay, do you guys have any doubts? Is it clear? You can take a 2 minutes break, because 1.5 hour continuously I've taken in so much of new information. Is the speed or the pace okay? Okay, guys. We are still on the second components. We still have 3 more components to go. Now let's see how this goes. I think I'm not explaining it in too much of detail or too much of depth, and I'm also not taking it like over and above it. I think I'm going at a right amount of explanation for you guys. So yes, so even if it, if even if this class gets elongated a little bit, try to adjust with it, okay? Again, guys, can take a 2 minutes break and then we'll resume back. Also, a lot of people, once I told I am not feeling well yesterday, a lot of people very caringly came to me and asked me if I was okay, if I was doing okay, and all of this thing. Thank you so much for all the care, guys. What just happened was before like 2 to 3 days back, I have become very inactive, okay? So just I thought that I would start my workouts back again. I was going to gym back, back lockdown and all those days. So what happened was my gym just abruptly stopped in between, then I was not able to go to the gym. So then I, in between, I had a few workouts. Then after a long time, I had worked out. So I did, I was in very much motivated to do workout. Okay. So what I did, I did like 15 to, I did around 45 push-ups. I did 50 to 60 squats. I did all of this. All of a sudden, I didn't warm up also. It had been a long time. So my hands and legs got absolutely pumped up and I was in so much pain yesterday. So that is the reason I was not able to take the other class. Share capital, until 2 p.m. I was okay. But when I sat down to have my lunch, I was not able to even lift my hand. Okay, that was how much it was pumped up. So then I had to cancel the class. That was the reason, nothing else. And I was also feeling a little feverish also. So yes. So, two more minutes to go. Okay. So, I think the break is enough. Yes. So, we'll resume back. Okay. Yes, guys. So, what is virtual memory? So, in between, I told you that what happens sometimes is that if your RAM space is not sufficient, suppose you only have 4 GB of RAM and you have opened already for 3.8 GB, suppose. What happens is that if you want to open one more application, in such case, what will happen is that if this application is suppose of 500 MB or 1 GB, what happens is that you'll not be able to open it in the RAM. Okay, you'll not be able to open it in the RAM. So in such case, what happens is your phones will start hanging. But here they have brought in a solution to this one. That solution is known as your virtual memory. So what happens is that, once again guys, so here as you can see, this is your secondary storage. This is your RAM. Okay, so what happens is if the memory or the storage in RAM has got full, and if you want to open one more application, in such case, what will happen is that the RAM will take the help of secondary memory. What it will do is, in your secondary memory, if suppose this is your secondary memory, in this secondary memory, this RAM will take a part. This RAM will create a part. This is known, this you can call it as your fake RAM. In your secondary memory, it will create something known as a fake RAM, or it can also be known as your virtual memory. This is actually not a RAM, but inside your secondary storage, you build a small memory known as imaginary memory. This is actually imaginary memory called a virtual memory. You build a memory here, and for the time being, till the RAM is full, the app will be using this RAM. This imaginary RAM which has been built in your secondary storage. Now, if I read, you'll be able to understand. See. So, suppose if your RAM is 4 GB and if you have already opened 10 apps for 3.8 GB, then when you open the 11th app, what will happen? Your phone will start hanging or it will slow down. But it will never say no. Okay, so whenever you try to open 11th RAM, no, it will never say that no, our RAM is full. We cannot open the application right now. It will never say so. Why will it not never say so? It is because of the virtual memory. Even though your RAM is full, it will create a virtual memory in your secondary memory. That is a part of secondary memory for the time being will be converted as RAM. And this is known as a virtual memory. And once your RAM is free, again, this will be deleted from your secondary memory and you'll use your primary RAM. So, That means when your RAM is full, in such case, a part of your secondary memory, a part of your secondary memory will be used as RAM, will be used as RAM temporarily so that your 11th app can be opened. So when you again clear your space in the RAM, the secondary memory will get released. Okay, the part of the secondary memory, which is the virtual memory, will get released. So the RAM which you create temporarily in the secondary memory is known as your virtual memory. The RAM which you create temporarily in the secondary memory is known as a virtual memory. Okay, yes. So now, have you guys understood what virtual memory? So I've got a comment here. After this, can you give a quick revision? I don't think I'll have the time to revise it in this lecture. Maybe in the next lecture when we start, I'll revise it. That is virtual memory clear, guys? Is this virtual RAM present in all mobile phones as inbuilt? This is not actually an inbuilt thing. Whenever you don't have RAM, enough space in RAM, it is an imaginary memory that you create. This is not something inbuilt, but your phone knows that if something like this happens, you have to create a virtual memory. The thing, that process is inbuilt. Okay, so here we'll read. Okay, virtual memory is in fact not a separate device, not a separate storage device. It is an imaginary memory area. Memory area. Okay. If a computer lacks, it is required in size, if a computer lacks the required size of RAM to run a program or to open an operation, the operating system which is there, you know, that is your Android or iOS, it uses the virtual memory to compensate. So virtual memory combines the computer's RAM with temporary space on the hard disk. Hard disk means nothing but your secondary memory. It combines the temporary space, okay? And when RAM runs low, virtual memory moves data from RAM to a space called a paging file. The space that you open in your secondary memory is also known as paging file. Okay, so moving data to and from the paging file frees up RAM to complete its work and increases the speed and utilization as more program can run at the same time. Virtual memory is allocation of hard disk space to help RAM. Hard disk means it is an allocation. This is the perfect sentence. Virtual memory is allocation of your secondary memory space to help RAM. Okay, I hope the virtual memory is clear to you guys. So yes, so we'll just see until how much have we completed. All these texts is available in your ICI textbook, guys. Okay, so we started with people, we completed that. We started with hardware. In hardware, we had input, processing, output, and data. We completed all the four subdivisions. Okay. So now we have completed hardware also. Next, what we are going to see is we are going to study about, let me see, what is the next topic I've written? We are going to study about, very good. We are going to study about software. What just happened? One second, guys. Yes. Okay. Now we are going to study about software next. Okay. So how, okay, you guys can tell me. So actually, there are two types of software, okay? My computer, one second, please. Okay, as you can see here on my screen. Okay, so software. So software can be of two types, guys. It can be operating system software or it can be application software. So operating system software is the software that is inbuilt in your mobile phone. Whereas application software means nothing but your apps, which is installed in the phone. It is inbuilt and this is installed. Okay, so you have two types of software. One is operating system software and the other one is application software. Okay, operating system software. Now first we will study about application software. You know, guys, this is nothing but it is a software, or these apps are used for specific functions. Suppose if you want to view a PDF, you can download a PDF viewer. If you want to play games, you can download a PUBG, or you can download your Angry Birds, or Ninja, what do you say, Ninja Knife, I don't remember. If you want to watch videos, you can download your YouTube. If you want to watch, if you want to text, you can download WhatsApp, you can use your Instagram, you can use your Twitter, or if you want to do video calling, you can install Skype or Zoom or Duo and all those apps like that. So application software means nothing but your apps. So this software is used for specific functions according to the user's specific needs. So according to what the user needs are, this specific functions are built, and according to what your need is, you can install it and use. So this is what is application software. Now we'll read about operating software. So main difference between application software and operating software is that operating software is not user specific. It is not user specific. According to one each and every users, your operating system software will not be made. Operating software is something which is used for the general functioning of the phone or laptop. Whereas application software was user specific for doing specific functions, whereas operating software is performing the general functions of a mobile phone or a computer. Okay, so now you guys will tell me, now I'll give you a few examples of operating software, then I'll ask you a question you need to answer. So the different kinds of operating system software are Windows, iOS, Android. This iOS and Android can be found in mobile phones. Likewise, in laptops or computers, you may have Linux, you may have Windows, you may have iOS, all of these things. Okay. So now you guys will tell me what phone do you have, or what do you prefer more? Do you prefer iOS more or Android more, and why? What do you prefer more? Do you prefer iOS phones more or Android phones more? And why? Why do you prefer these? What is the difference? First, tell me what you prefer. Fast, okay? Android. I am also an Android user, so I prefer Android more. iOS is restricted, so you prefer Android. Okay, what else? Why do you prefer Android more than iOS? Okay, now I have got a majority answer for Android. Why is that you prefer Android more and iOS less? Because I'll tell you a few answers. Because Android, yes, Android is more user friendly. It is Android is not okay, cheaper in cost. Okay, the phones are cheaper in cost which have Android. I'm talking about software here, not the mobile phones. Look into the software part. It is user friendly, very good. More customizable. Certain apps will not be supported by iOS. Very good, awesome, nice. What else? Okay, so whenever you do the Android versus iPhone battle, okay, or whenever you do this, whenever I ask something, adaptable, okay. So the main thing of why many people, I feel, or I personally choose Android over iOS is that the functioning of Android is way more user friendly and way more simpler to use. If you want to share things, it is easier to share. There are a lot of apps which is available in Android than iOS. So there are a lot of things which are different in iOS and Android. So this is what is the basic difference between both the softwares. Okay, so the operating of these both softwares is different, right? How Android operates is different from how iOS operates. So I hope what operating system software is different. So here, you know, Android for each and every person in the world, it is not different. Likewise, each and every iOS software is not different for each and every person in the world. If you feel the operating system of iOS is more better for you, you can go for iOS. If you feel the operating system software, that is Android, is more user friendly or more adaptable to you, you can go for Android. So operating system is nothing but it is a software which helps the basic functioning of a mobile phone or a laptop. I hope the difference between application system software and operating system software is clear to you all. Okay, is it clear, guys? Do you guys have any doubts on what operating system software means or what application software means? We'll just go through the text anyway. Do you guys have any doubts? Yes, no, clear. Okay, so we'll read a little bit about operating system. Okay, so I'm not here reading about either it is operating system, I'm studying not about application system, but here I'm going to study about the operating system. Okay, that is your your Android, iOS, Windows, Linux, all of that. So here they tell you the operating system is a set of computer programs that manages the computer hardware and acts as an interface with computer application programs. Okay, so what this operating system does is that it helps the computer to use all its hardware. Okay, It helps a computer to use its hardware resources. That means to use a mouse, to use the keyboard, to all use these things. It will help the computer to use it. Now, suppose if you see, you know, wait, I'll give you an example. One second, just hold on a minute. What do you have? So, you know, there will be a few devices. There will be a few devices which you can use in your few devices. What are the few devices? Okay, we'll take the example of AirPods. You guys tell me, can AirPods? AirPods are nothing but your wireless earphones, okay, which is made by the Apple company. Can this AirPods be used by an Android mobile user? Android mobile. Say I have a Mi mobile. Can my Mi mobile use the AirPods or can connect with the AirPods? Can my Mi phone connect with AirPods or not? No. Why? Have you ever given a thought? Why is it not able to connect with AirPods? Whereas Mi itself has its Mi also has its wireless for your phones. I just don't exactly remember what it is called. It must be something around the name Pods only. I don't know. So Mi also has its own wireless earphones, but Mi phones connect to that wireless earphones, whereas This AirPods it will not be able to connect. Why? Why earbuds? I don't know. Why is it not able to connect? Is because different OS and yes, very good, very good. One person has given the answer, but I'll not read it aloud because I want to explain it to you guys. Okay. So what happens is that so like this only they have told you. According to what operating system software you have in your mobile or on your laptop, it will help you connect with the hardware related to it. If you have Mi, it will connect, it will help you manage or connect to the hardware that is related to that operating software. Or if you have an Apple or iOS operating system, according to that, whatever hardware resources it is managing, it will help you connect with that. Okay, so it acts as a interface between your computer application programs also. Okay, so application programs, I've already told you. Application programs requires an operating system to function. So application program means, you know, certain apps need iOS to function. Means there will be a few apps in your like your movie editor. You have this Apple movie editor on your Mac laptops. That Apple movie editor you don't have on your Windows laptop, or that app you can also not install in your Windows laptop. So according to whatever app you need, according to that, the operating system should also be there. So whatever applications you want use, according to that, your operating system is also important, because your application requires an operating system to function, which provides a convenient environment for the users to execute their program. Okay, here they have given you a few examples of operating system. Okay, so here they have given you features of operating system. Okay, the first features, they have given you features of application software also, and also regarding to operating system software. Now we'll study about the features of operating system software and features of application system software. And then we'll come back. Okay, or else what we'll do is, this features of operating system and application software, we'll read it at the end if we have time. Okay, because I want to mainly explain you the concept. Then if you read these features, you'll be able to easily understand by yourself. Okay, see, performing hardware functions, I just told you what it means. Okay, so this in the end we'll study. Now we'll move on to the next component. Okay. In the end, please remind me if I do forget. Okay, please remind me. Okay, where were we? We completed our hardware, we completed software. In software, there are two types. One was operating system and other was application software. We completed our people also. Then now we are going to go on to the next component. We have completed three components. Okay, next component, this is a huge, huge component. The next component is data. I told you there are five components: hardware, software, data, network, people. We have already completed hardware, software, and people. We have two left. One is data and the other one is network. Data is a bigger part. Network is a small part only, like your software. So data is also a little bit technical, but interesting, just like your hardwares. Okay. So now let's start with this. Just give me a minute, guys. One second. Just a second, guys. One second, I'll be back, okay? Sorry guys, I just went to get water for myself. Okay, so now we'll start with data resources. Okay, so in data resources, I'll just show you an overview what is there. So you have four classifications in data. One is data, database, database management system, database models, and then also you have terms related to database, under which you again have big data, data warehouse, and data mining. This is also very interesting, believe me guys. Okay, you're going to have a lot of fun reading this. Okay, so yes, okay, now let's start with this. Okay so what happens is, here there are two kinds of grocery stores which are being seen on the screen. One is a very messy okay grocery store, and one is neatly arranged grocery store. Which one would you prefer? Right one is, this is one, this is two. Just answer in one or two. Which one will you prefer to go? Two. Why will you prefer two in messy? Also, you have a lot of whatever you need. If you want a boost, you will get boost here. If you want masala, you will get a masala here. If you want some vegetable, you will get there also, no, in the messy also. Neatly arranged, easy access. Other things, why you would like to go to the neatly arranged store? Two, okay, why will you go there? It is organized and easy to access. Okay, very good. Okay, categorized, easy to choose. Okay, very nice, guys. So this is also what we are going to study actually in data. This is only, okay. So here what happens is, in this messy grocery store also, you'll get all the items that you require. Likewise, same in the neatly arranged store also. But what happens is that when this is so messy, you will not be able to, access or identify the identify the things that you need at the correct time. Now, if you are in urgent, you are in a rush, and you want some information or some product from the store, it will take a lot of time for you to search. Whereas if you go in a neatly arranged store, if you need this information or this product, directly you can go take it and use it. Correct. So this is the difference between messy and neatly arranged store. Now see this. I'll show you. So what happens is that the messy store which we saw there, messy grocery store, it's your data. The neatly arranged store that you saw is your database. The messy store, messy grocery store is your data. Everything you have there also. The same things only you will have on your database also. That is in a neatly arranged grocery store also. But the difference is that it is correctly organized in a neatly arranged store, whereas in a messy store, it is not organized. Okay. So I hope the difference between data and database is clear to you guys. Now we'll read through the text so you understand better. Data is nothing a raw fact, unprocessed bits and pieces of information with no context. Just like a messy grocery store, you have all the things there, but it has no context. Here and there, everything is just spread out. Now we'll read it in terms of EIS. Okay,
okay, the meeting is going to end, it seems. So we'll just quit and we'll get back. Now we are going to study about data. Okay, data, they have told you data is a raw fact and unprocessed bits and pieces of information with no context. Now if I tell you, my father's, suppose my father's weight is 70 kilos and his height is suppose 5'9". Okay, what are you able to derive out of this? What is this use to you? What is the use of this? If I tell you my father is 70 kilos, what is the use? There is no use, right? This is what is data. This is some kind of a data, okay. But it is an unprocessed data. From this data, you cannot derive anything, okay. Okay, so this is what they're telling. This is a raw fact. This is just facts. That my father is 70 kilo. That is a fact. My father is 5'9". That is a fact. Okay. This is just an unprocessed bits and pieces of information, guys. Okay. This is very unprocessed. There's nothing processed with this. You cannot do anything. It has no context. This is what is data. This data can either be quantitative, quantitative, or it can be qualitative. It can be in the form of alpha numeric, it can be numeric, or it can be alphabets. So it can be in any form. Data can be in any form. Okay, I can tell you my friend's name is Ria. What are you going to understand from that? Okay, her name is Ria. Then what? That will be your next question, right? Okay. So that is why they're telling it can be either in the form of qualitative or quantitative. But what happens is that, are you able to hear some kind of a bell sound, guys, in the background? Are you able to hear some kind of a bell sound? No, right? Okay. They're doing some kind of a puja here, it seems. I don't know. Okay, fine. So what happens is that the data is just a raw, unprocessed bits and pieces of information with no context. But once data is processed, it will get converted into a meaningful information. Once data is processed, it can be converted into a meaningful information. So unprocessed thing is data. Once you process the data, when you try to derive, okay, from this 5'9" and 70 kgs, yeah, suppose you apply something, you process this data, you apply a BMI index, body mass index, okay, and you say whether he is underweight or overweight or normal. Okay, once this data in itself is based. But once you process this data, you will get some kind of information which will be useful for you. Using that, you can take some kind of information. So that is the difference between data and information. Okay. So once you process the data, it will be converted into meaningful information. This information which you have got can be used for decision making and analysis. If he is underweight, you can prescribe him something. Okay. Prescribe that you must eat this, you must not eat this, something. Decision making and analysis. Likewise, in a entity or in enterprise also, you'll have a lot of data. Once the data is processed, you'll get information. Then that information which you get, that will be used for decision making and analysis. Okay, that is what is data. So here, see the image, you'll be able to understand better. See, data is there. Data is nothing but your raw facts. Once you do analysis on that, then you will get the idea about it. This idea is nothing but your information. So for this only I have put in pictures here, so you are able to understand better. So this is your data. Okay. Next is your database. This is how your database looks, guys. So here you can see a lot of data is getting stored into a database file. But here all the database is not just dumped into this. Rather, you can see that in this database, you have separate columns. Here one storage bin is there. Here one storage is there. Here one storage is there. Here one storage is there. So what will happen is database, just like your neatly arranged grocery store, whatever your detergents are there, all those things will be stored together. Whatever your washroom cleaning products are there, all that will be stored together, or all will be arranged together. Whatever your kitchen related stuffs are there, that will be put in one place. Whatever your chocolates, biscuits are there, all that will be put in one place. So like this, whatever products are related to each other in a logical way, they all will be put together. What did I just say? Whatever products are related to each other in a logical way, all of these things will be put together. Likewise, same thing in a database, guys. So whatever data is related to each other logically will be stored at one place. So different sets of data, different places. Whatever is logically related to each other will be stored at one place in a database. So that if you want to access one information, you'll be easily able to access that. Okay? So this is how a database looks. If more, the more pictures you see, the more you'll be able to understand better. Okay, database. So database is nothing but like a neatly arranged grocery store. So set of logically interrelated collection of data, organized collection of data. Logically, it is logically related. Okay. Next is, it is also organized and it is a collection of data. So the same data what you have here, if you put it like this in logical sets and organize it, it will become a database. In that database, using the data, you can then process it and get some information, whatever you want. Okay, so I hope data and database is clear to you guys. Do you guys have any doubts in what is data and what is a database? What is the data and what is a database? So this is your data and this is your database. No, right? I hope it is clear. Okay, very nice. Okay, guys, next. Now we have completed two things. I told you I'll talk about four things in this. One is data, next is database, then you have database management system and database models. We have already completed data, database. Now we are going to study about database management system. So what happens is that, see, now whenever you go to a grocery store, and take the same example of grocery store. So what happens is that your first, what you do whenever you start a grocery store, whenever you start a grocery store, it will be very messy. Then with the help of a few people, you will neatly arrange it. So what happens is, once you, if you have neatly arranged it and opened your grocery store, is that enough? Or do you need a few people to manage it throughout the day? On 1st September, you started a new grocery store. That time it was messy. Then on 2nd September, you arranged everything in an organized manner and it became a neatly arranged grocery store. Then after that, till the next year, it is you just leave it like that. Is that correct? Or you need some people to manage and arrange it? You need some kind of help. Or the database can be as such as it is. Do you need people who manage it? Yes or no? Answer. You need people to manage. Yes? Right? Yes, very good. So like that only, once your data is converted into database, it is not important that you just leave it like that. You will need a database management system. It will manage the database, like how the people or the employees or the staff of the supermarket manages the neatly arranged grocery store. Okay. Yes. Also, these people also help the customer. If they want something, they'll help. Like that, this database management system will also help the user. If he wants to derive some data, he can go and ask the database management system that, please help me to get this data. This data management system will then go to database and get the data you want. Now, once we study through this, you will be able to understand. So just see this once. So this is, so I told you, right? Once again. So I already told you, right? This is your database. This is how your database looks. I already showed you the picture here. So these databases, there will be a lot, many kinds of databases in your, in your entity. Google, suppose think of Google. Google has so much of data. Then how much databases will it have? Lot and lot of databases. All these databases should be managed, which is known as a database management system. So see this picture so you are able to remember it for a longer time. Okay? Okay, guys. So now we'll read through what is database management system. So database management system, DBMS, may be defined as a software. So this is nothing but a software that help or aid in organizing, controlling and using the data needed by the application program. So if you open an app, okay, if you open an app and that app requires some kind of a data which is stored in the database, this database management system will go and get it for you. Like that, it will also organize the data and control the data also. It will provide the facility to create and maintain a well-organized database. So it will help the database to remain and maintain it as well-organized. Okay. So I hope this and all is clear to you all already. Examples of database will be Oracle, SQL, MySQL, servers, and DB2. These are a few examples of database management system. Please remember the examples. It may be asked in your exam for one mark. That is in your MCQs, basically. Database management system is also clear to you guys. So now there are various operations that can be performed on these files or using this database management system. So there are various operations that these database management system. Now we'll understand that in the point of view of this lady. On point of view of this lady. So this lady who is working in a neatly arranged grocery store, she can add products to the grocery store, right? So whenever there is a new product arrival, she can add that product to the database. Okay. Like that, she can also delete. If something has expired, she can also throw it away. If something is not needed or not required by the customers anymore, she can throw away whatever is already existing. She can delete whatever the products are there. Inserting data into existing files. So what happens is there are already a few rin bars. Already a few rin bars or washing soaps. If there are a few more stock of washing soaps that has come into the grocery store, she can add it along with the existing existing soap bars. So new soap bars also she can new kind of product also she can add, or existing product extra stock if it has come, she can add it with the existing product itself, modifying the existing files. That means existing files itself modifying data. That means what suppose happens is that now what happened is you had three Kurkure packets. You had a three Lay's packets. You had, these are already the data which was existing. What happened is this was not getting sold at all. Okay. This was not getting sold at all. So what they did was they made a modification and they packed all these three together and put a super sale on it. Then buy two, get one free. Like that you get some packets in the supermarket, right? Like that you can modify whatever the existing files are already there. Next is deleting the data in existing files. So, okay. So, whatever the existing file data is there, that you can, here you deleted the existing file from the database itself. Here, from the existing files, you can delete. Suppose what I can say, in a product, what happens is that, suppose there was this product. There was, if you buy a Bourbon packet, if you buy a Boost, you will get a racket free. Oh, in old we had, you know, you'll get a racket, badminton racket free. So in this existing, this was already existing. This is not a new product or something. This is already existing. In that, what they do is they remove this racket offer. They just keep the boost with them. So this is deleting data in the existing file itself, or retrieving or querying data from the existing files. That means if you have any query, this can be understood only in the information system. If you have any query, you can make. Okay, so these are all the various operations that can be performed using the database management systems. So now we have completed three things. Okay, see here I have written, see, you also have advantages and disadvantages, which is given at, why is this not working? What happened? One second, guys. Okay, so yeah, advantages and disadvantages also. All these things, you know, if you read by your own, you'll be able to understand. I'm here to make you understand the concept. If I start teaching you advantages, disadvantages, and all, a lot of time will get wasted in the class. I don't want to do that. Whenever I have time, I'll try to upload it on YouTube some other day. Okay, I'm here to explain the concept, and I think I'm doing it properly right now. Okay, data we have completed, database we have completed, database management system also we have completed. Next, we are going to see database models. So what are these database models? So see, data can be stored in different forms. Now, suppose we'll take the example of, give me a second, please. Let me just think. Okay. I'll give you simpler examples so you're able to understand, and then we'll read it from the technical point of view. Now, suppose you have a fridge in your home. Now, if you have fridge in your home, you will have fruits and vegetables which you store. Okay. So, I'll give you a few examples on how you can store these fruits or vegetables in the fridge, which is there in your home. What happens is you may store your fruits outside the fridge and vegetables inside the fridge. Or this is one type. Second type, what you may do is all the fruits and also the tomatoes and all the onions alone you will store it outside the fridge. All other vegetables you will store it inside the fridge. This is second type. Third type is that both the fruits and vegetables, you store it inside the fridge itself. Or what happens is, in the first rack, you store your fruits. In the last rack, you store your vegetables. Again, there may be different kinds. How you can store the same thing? The same thing, you can store it in different models. Likewise, data in a database can also be stored in different ways. What did I just say? Like how you store your fruits and vegetables in different types in your fridge, different models in your fridge. Likewise, the same data in a database, which is stored in a database, can be stored in different models. What are the different models by which you can store your databases? Data is what we are going to study now. So that is nothing but your database models. That means how and all you can store your data in a database. What are the different methods by which you can store, or what are the different models by which you can store your data in a database is what we are going to understand now. Okay. So this hierarchy of database, okay. So whenever you store a data in a database, okay, and now we are not studying about the models now. Generally, I'm telling you about database, general information about database alone I'm saying, okay. So whenever you, So whenever you store a data in database, let it be any model, okay. Whenever you store a data in a database, you always follow a hierarchy. You always follow a hierarchy. Is my voice breaking, guys? Is my voice okay now? When did it start breaking? Is it clear now? When did my voice started breaking? When I was, what was I explaining? I'll just repeat it once again. It is breaking. Okay, I'll just end the meeting and we can be back again.